So welcome to another session of Microsoft Virtual Academy. This time we're talking about PowerShell with System Center 2012 SP1. My name is Andreas Reins. I'm a data center architect, and I will guide you through that session today. So we will talk about some basic stuff about automation, and I will give you an intro to PowerShell, and then we will walk through to Windows PowerShell and System Center 2012 SP1. And at the end, I will also talk about the integration points, how you make PowerShell work together across Windows Server and System Center, as well as I will give you a couple of demos to show you what you can do with PowerShell and System Center 2012 SP1. So the objectives for today is to learn the basics for automation and how to leverage Windows PowerShell to make it real, understand the great value PowerShell can deliver to automate administrative tasks, and learn how System Center and Windows are tightly integrated with Windows PowerShell. So let's get started giving you an intro to automation. So now I would like to give you some of the key benefits of automation. There are a couple of reasons why you want to automate some tasks that you do manually today. First of all, it will reduce your costs. It is highly automated then. It will be managed centralized. It will increase the productivity, it will increase time to market, and it will also increase the scalability, and it will increase the quality of your services. And you can offer those automation tasks to your end users, for example. So it's really, there are really a couple of key benefits you get from automation, using automation. And one of the technologies you can use to make your tasks that you do manually today to automate is Windows PowerShell. So right now I will give you a very quick intro what PowerShell is. Windows PowerShell is a task-based command line shell and a scripting language that's built on .NET, the .NET framework. So it will provide full access to COM, to WMI, to really give you the power to perform administrative tasks both locally and on remote Windows systems. And those administrative tasks are generally performed by so-called commandlets. So those commandlets are specialized .NET classes, and they are implementing a specific operation. And you can access data in different data stores like the registry, the file system, databases. And they're all made available to the PowerShell runtime with Windows PowerShell providers. So besides that, Windows PowerShell has also a hosting API that helps you embedding Windows PowerShell inside other applications. So these other applications can then use Windows PowerShell functionality to implement certain operations. And one good example of that capability is Microsoft Exchange Server 2007. It was actually exposing its management functionality as PowerShell commandlets and providers and implement the management tool, the graphical management tool from Exchange as a PowerShell host, which invoked then the necessary commandlets. There are a couple of other examples out there, like Microsoft SQL Server 2008, which was implementing the management interface using a PowerShell commandlets as well. And so getting to the history and the different versions of PowerShell, we were starting with version 1.0 back in 2006 of PowerShell, which was released for Windows XP, Windows Server 2003, and Vista, and it was also optionally available for Windows Server 2008. With Windows 7 and 2008 R2, we released version 2.0. We introduced it a couple of cool features like remoting, like background jobs. We introduced the try-catch finally plug, which helps you to do exception handling. We added transactions to Windows PowerShell. And then with Windows 8 and Windows Server 2012, we released version 3.0 of PowerShell. And having that as well as on Windows 7 SP1, Windows Server 2008 SP1, as well as R2 SP1. And with Windows PowerShell 3.0, we introduced things like session connectivity and also scheduled jobs and a couple of other things. And to give you a quick intro on different terms that I was already using and I will use in the next few slides and also throughout my demos, one thing that I already mentioned are so-called commandlets. And I described it a bit. So commandlets are specialized commands that implement specific functions, native commands in the PowerShell stack. So for example, if you go and look to the commandlets that System Center Operations Manager is providing, there are commandlets that are called install scum agent, for example, or get scum management server. Those are commandlets that provide specific functionality to you to write your scripts around that. Another important term when it comes to PowerShell are pipeline. So the pipeline, it's a concept that enables the output of one commandlet to be piped as input to another commandlet. So for example, you can use the commandlet get process, which will actually deliver as an output, will deliver all the processes on your machine, and then you can use the pipeline concept to use that output from get process to use it as an input to another commandlet, which might be for each object, which then goes and iterates through all the outputs from get process and do some other stuff with that. So pipelining is a very strong concept, and you will see that in a second when I'll give you some quick demos about PowerShell and some basic stuff around Windows PowerShell. And again, Windows PowerShell really includes that dynamic typed scripting language, which can really implement complex operations using commandlets. The scripting language supports variables, functions, branching, error exception handling, and as well as an integration with .NET. So right now we'll dig into some PowerShell integration stuff, and then we'll go right into the first demo to show you the power of Windows PowerShell. So PowerShell, the PowerShell integration, it really helps you to automate tasks of Windows, of System Center, and application, and it will It's built on top of the .NET framework, the common language runtime, CLR, and the .NET framework, and it accepts .NET framework options, which is a fundamental difference to other scripting languages. Typically, a .NET framework object is an instance of a .NET framework class that consists of data and the operations associated with that data, and we'll see that in a demo in a second. And best of all, you do not have to give up the tools that you have become accustomed to using. You can still use traditional Windows tools such as NAT, SC, RegEx in Windows PowerShell. They are all valid and you can use them still in Windows PowerShell. And it's integrated in all major Windows client and server versions, which I laid out when I talked about the history and the different versions. So right now, let's go into the first demo and give you a quick intro into PowerShell and a couple of basic commands that you should be familiar when you get started with Windows PowerShell. So here are we on the Windows Server 2012 box. It's a basic installation of a Windows Server 2012 virtual machine. Down here you have the icon to start Windows PowerShell, the command interface. So that's what you see if you're starting that. And then you can get started using the commandlets. And one of the commandlets is get service, for example. So if you hit enter here, what you will see is a list of all your services that are on your machine. If you scroll up a little bit, what you see is the status, so if the service is running or stopped, the name of that, and the display name. So what else you can do other than getting all a list of all your services? So if you go back and enter get service, and then you're using the pipeline concept that I mentioned before, you can actually pipe in that output of that get service commandlet and filter some services out there. So in this case, we want to just get the service that's called themes. So I'm going to enter where the name of all the get service output is equals to themes, and if I enter that, the result is just one line, which is actually the one service that's actually currently stopped. So right now you just see those three columns, status, name, and display name. But there are certainly a couple of more columns available and data properties available, as well as methods that you can actually do on that get service commandlet. So how do you get to know those properties and methods? So you type in get service, use another pipe, and get member, which will list all the properties and methods that are available for get service. And you can see a couple of those properties we've seen already, and there are a couple of more that are available, as well as the methods like start and stop in this case. So for example, if we want to use a variable, we can name the variable service. We say get service again. We're using the same commandlet and the same pipe as we did before. So we are looking for a name that equals to themes. So right now we don't see any output because the output was piped into the variable called service. So if you are now enter service and hit enter, you'll see the same output that you saw before without the variable. Another way of getting just a specific property like name is typing in the variable dot name, and then you just get back the name of that service like themes. So one thought that came across your mind probably throughout the last seconds that I show you all the demos is, isn't there a better way to write my scripts? And yes, there is. So if you type PowerShell ISE, you'll see the Windows PowerShell integrated scripting environment loading up, and that's a way more powerful editor to write your scripts. Right now it wasn't started as admin, so this is one way to starting that, but it's not in administrative mode, so we cannot, for example, stop a service. So I go ahead and go to start it from here. So I'll just type in IZ, right click on that, and run as admin. So it will stop the editor again. And up here in the top window, you're able to write your scripts. So again, we will use a variable for the service. And immediately what you saw is that we have some IntelliSense here that helps you writing your scripts and your commandlets. So for this time, we're again using get service. Then we're using the pipe. We're again filtering for a specific service. Again, we're just, because it's easy, we're using the themes service, and then we are trying to get the status of that service. So once you've done your script, you can hit the run script or F5 button here, and the output will be shown in the window below. So in this case, we'll see that the status of the service is stopped. So now we have a variable with the service, and now we want to get some output from there. So we're using another commandlet that's called write host, and we'll take the variable and add the information about the name of that service and the status, and we want to output that here. So if we hit that button up here or press F5, you will see the script is running and the output is shown in the window below. So in this case, we see the status of themes is stopped. So now we are adding one more line because we want to actually stop that service. So we are going ahead and we are now not accessing a property, but we're calling a method from that commandlet. So we just press F5 again or that button, and the output is the same, but if we run it again, and this time we're just running those two lines up here because it was already started the service. So let me just highlight that. Just those two lines, and you have another button next to the run script button, which is called run selection. So in this time it won't run the whole the whole script here, but just the selected part of that. So you'll see that the status of themes is running now instead of stopped before, because we've started that service already. So right now the service is started, so actually we want to stop that service, and then we want to see if the status really was changed by that method, by calling that method. So we just copy and paste the first two lines again, and just to see the values. So let me just clean the output here and run the full script. So either hitting F5 or pressing that button here, and you see that the status before we called the method stop is running, and then again we're having the same output, the status of the themes service, and now it's stop pending. So if we just run that again, we'll see, and just hit the run selection button, so F8, we'll see that now it's stopped already. So this way you can actually work with commandlets. You saw the properties that are available, you saw how to use methods, and you got some ideas on how Windows PowerShell is working. So I'll give you another example. So another commandlet is the get process. So just let me just clean that here and run that simple script here, get process. It will give you an output for all the processes that are currently running on your machine, on that machine that we're running that. And now we want to output something from that. So we're using another pipe, and this time we're using the for each object commandlet. And then we are using again write host to so that will give us some output here, and we're using the name property of that get process, and then we're using something that's called foreground color, and we say use green for that, and then we're done here, and then we just run that result, just clean that before so that you see the output. So we are just getting the name of all the processes that are currently running, and we're using a different color than the normal color. So one thing that I mentioned, so you can use all your commands that you've used before Windows PowerShell. So for example, if you run ipconfig, which is familiar to most people, you can use, for example, find string, pipe that as well, and let's just run ipconfig without the other find string here, just run the selection. You see the standard ipconfig output that you're used to, and we can use the pipe here, find string, run the selection again, and you see the only output you will get is the lines with the address string in it. So that was the demo for giving you an intro to PowerShell, and now let's dig into the System Center PowerShell commandlets and what you can do with that. So getting back to the slide deck for a bit, so I'll talk a little bit about PowerShell and System Center 2012 SP1. So you saw a couple of those out-of-the-box commandlets already throughout the demo to work with services, with processes, and many more things that you can do, automate Windows Server alone. But when it comes to System Center 2012 SP1, I would like to give you a quick overview about the different components and how they are interacting with PowerShell, and how you can automate System Center 2012 SP1 components using those PowerShell commandlets. So I will go quickly over every component out of System Center 2012 SP1, and then I'll give you a couple of demos for Operations Manager, for VMM, and an orchestrator. So let's start with App Controller. So we have a list of App Controller commandlets that comes with the product or with the component. So we have about 31 commandlets. You can actually manage your Azure services. You can working with Azure. You can work with your images. You can work with your Azure disks. You can work with all the security involved, like users, roles, scopes, and all that stuff. You can actually managing your Azure account using PowerShell commandlets. So you can manage your subscription, your Azure subscription. You can change your admin settings, and so on. So those are the opportunities and the power that you'll get with App Controller commandlets. Next component is Configuration Manager. That's way bigger than an app controller, also from a PowerShell commandlets perspective. So we have about almost 500 commandlets only for configuration manager. So you have those different verbs here, like add, enable, disable, export, import, get, set, update, new, remove, and all the different things like creating collections, adding computers to collections, importing, exporting data out of configuration manager. You can create stuff, you can remove that, you can update and set data within configuration manager, both from an administrative perspective, like security stuff, as well as creating your full deployment and things that you're working day in and day out with SCCM, just using commandlets and those almost 500 commandlets that are coming with the product with SCCM 2012 SP1. So the next component from System Center 2012 SP1 I would like to talk about is Data Protection Manager. Again, very powerful, a lot of commandlets out of the box, about 125 commandlets that are available. So you can manage your full Data Protection Manager environment. You can work with your production groups, production service, you can work with the libraries, with the tapes, with the data sources, and you can manage all the security involved, like roles, security groups. And here you also find a link to the reference of all the commandlets that are available. And the next slide shows you all the commandlets that are available. You don't have to learn them. They're all documented very well online. But it's just there to show you the power of the commandlets and the opportunities that are there to automate your data protection manager environment. So the next component I'd like to talk about and also give you a demo on how to use it is Operations Manager. So with Operations Manager, we'll have about 150 commandlets. Again, you can manage your whole environment, your whole SCUM environment, your management packs, your settings, your security. You can work with the alerts. You can resolve them. You can set the resolution states. You can install and uninstall agents. You can also manage your agentless computers. And there's also a support for Unix and Linux. So installing and uninstalling the agents and updating the agents. That's all provided by the commandlets with SCUM. And again, the link to get the reference to all the different commandlets. And here is a quick list on the different commandlets that are available. So right now, I'd jump to my demo environment and show you how to work with PowerShell to automate a SCUM agent installation using only PowerShell without going to the Operations Manager console at all. So we're back in my demo environment, and the purpose of that script is actually automating the way I'm able to deploy a SCUM agent to a specific VM. So in this case, I've declared two variables. One is the VM that I'm going to use to deploy an agent to, and the other one is the SCUM server itself. So in this case, it's test01. Contoso.com for the VM where I want to deploy the agent, and the SCUM server name is opsmanager01.contoso.com. You see a couple of write hosts in between the lines of the script, so that's the only purpose for that. In this case, just to give some feedback to the user that is running the script to see that there is something going on. So the first thing I'm going to do is actually creating a remote session to a remote host. So I want to go to talk to the SCUM server, which is Ops Manager 1 in this case, and create a session there. So we are creating a PowerShell remote session on that SCUM server. So I'm using another variable. So I've named that session, and I'm using commandlet that's called new PS session. And one attribute or one parameter I'm using is the computer name, which is actually the Ops Manager 01 VM. So then I'm going to use another commandlet, which is called invoke command. And I'm passing in the session that I've created before. And I'm also passing in the two variables that I've that I've declared here. So both this COM server name as well as the virtual machine manager name. So I'm passing that in and I'm invoking that command. So everything that comes after that invoke command, so all that up here, will be executed on this COM server, no longer on that machine where I'm running the script. So I can actually run that script on every machine. It will always go out and connect to that remote COM management server to run the main script here. So then again, I'm having another write host line that tells me that I'm importing the operations manager module. So that module has got all the commandlets that I mentioned before in the slide deck. So it will provide you with all the commandlets for SCOM. So we're using a try catch block here. So there is some sort of error handling in place as well. So if something goes wrong here in the try block here, so in those three lines, it will be catched and I'll get a write host line again that tells me something failed during the Ops Manager module was importing. So then I'm setting the primary management server. So I'm using another commandlet, which is already part of the SCOM module. So get SCOM management server using the SCOM server name that I've defined and passed into that remote PowerShell session will give me back the primary management server. Again, write the next line, write host, will just give me the information that I'm now going to install the SCOM agent on the virtual machine, in this case the test 01 machine. So I'm using an install output variable to catch the output of the commandlet install SCOM agent. So install SCOM agent, another commandlet from SCOM that will go out. It will take the name, virtual machine manager name, tester 1, and it will take the primary management server. That's the variable that we assigned here up here. And then it will go out and install the SCOM agent to that machine. Again, it will then go out and take the error code parameter from the output from install SCOM agent to make sure that if there is an error code, if there was an error happening during the installation, it will be catched. And if we scroll down a little bit, you can see that we're checking. So here we are using an if statement, and we're checking for that error code number. If that is not equal to zero, means that there was an error happening during the installation of this COM agent, and then we'll just write host and output that there was an error happening. Otherwise, Ops Manager agent on that machine, so in this case test 1, that's the assignment of that variable, has been installed successfully, and again we're using a different color to make it more easily to make it more readable. And then at the end, to not log in resources, we're removing that PowerShell session. So here we are back to the local machine and we're removing that PowerShell session on the remote host. In this case it was the SCOM server. So right now we can just go ahead and run that script by hitting that F5 button here. So we see all the output throughout the script, creating the session. We are importing the operations manager module. We are installing the ops manager agent on tester1.contoso.com. And in a couple of seconds we should see a couple of more lines that we are getting the error code and description, that we are checking for if the install script worked, and then at the last line should be that the Ops Manager agent was installed successfully on the test 01 VM. And then we are going to the SCOM server, starting the SCOM console, and see if that was really installed. So now we're done with our script. You can see that all the write hosts are there except the error installing this COM agent, because in our case the error code number was obviously it was zero, and the last line here is the Ops Manager agent on test01.contoso.com has been installed successfully. And now let's see if that really was working, and switching to the Ops Manager console. So now we are on the Ops Manager 01 VM, the one that we were using throughout the script. to do the remote session. So let's start the Operations Manager console and go straight to the administration pane once it's fully loaded. Okay, here we go. Switch to administration, and then let's go to the agent managed list. And you can see that test one, the VM that we used throughout the script, is already there. It's not monitored yet. That takes a couple of seconds. We don't wait for that. But I just want to show you that the script really, really is working. So back from the SCOM demo on how to use PowerShell and Operations Manager commandlets, there are a couple of more components I would like to highlight in that deck, and we'll see a couple of more demos. One of the components from the SystemCenter 2012 family is obviously Orchestrator, especially when it comes to automation, and we'll see another demo later in that session about Orchestrator. But right now I'd like to just highlight the way on how to automate Orchestrator itself, and there are a couple of commandlets that will help you to do that. So there are things like getting Orchestrator jobs or getting instances of a runbook, starting and stopping an Orchestrator runbook. So that's a way on how to automate Orchestrator. But later on I'll talk about how to use PowerShell within Orchestrator to make that story even better, and making that integration even better between Orchestrator, PowerShell, and all the other System Center components, and how to use that to automate your whole environment. Another component I'd like to highlight is Service Manager, obviously. So SystemCenter 2012 SP1 Service Manager. There are also a lot of commandlets available. About 120 commandlets are available. So you can manage all your administrative tasks, your data warehouse tasks. They are actually split into different commandlets. You can work with classes, you can work with objects, and I'll give you a demo right away. And here is the URL for reference to all the different commandlets. And here is a list of all the commandlets that are available for Service Manager. So now let's jump back to my demo environment and show you how to automate Service Manager and how to create an instance of a class within Service Manager using PowerShell only. So right now we are in my Service Manager VM, which is called SM01. I've already started the console for Service Manager, and as you can see, all printers, one of the configuration items that are there out of the box in Service Manager and one of the classes is empty in this environment. So now I would like to write a script using the PowerShell commandlets to create a new printer, to create an instance of that printer class that it's there out of the box. So let's switch over to the scripting environment. So let's go there. And what you can see is actually a script that is pretty basic. So first, what it does is actually it creates a new PowerShell session on the SM01 VM. So you already saw that's my Service Manager environment. So I'm creating a new PowerShell session using the new PS session commandlet. Then I'm using the invoke command, and I'm passing in that session that I've created here, so the variable session, to that invoke command. And from there, everything that you see here is running on that remote host on the SM01 box. So the first thing I'm going to do again is using the import module commandlet, which is actually importing all the Service Manager 2012 commandlets. And then I'm using one of the commandlets, which is called new SCSM class instance. And I'm using another one, the get SCSM class, to get me the printer class that it's that's already there out of the box. And then I'm passing in as an inline script all the data and all the variables that are required to create an instance of that printer class, which is the server name, printer name, location, nodes. That's something I'm passing in, and I'm running on the remote machine on the SM01 box. So I'm just running that script from here, and you can see it will be done in a few seconds. So here we go, and we're just switching over back to the service manager machine. So back in the console of service manager, you can see that the all printers list is already filled with one instance that we've created, and if we double click that, we'll see the form of that printer class, and you can see one of the, for example, the notes that we've added through the script, added by PowerShell script, that's there. So we've created that from PowerShell using the service manager commandlet. So now let's get back to the DAC and go on with the other components that are part of System Center 2012 SP1. Okay, last but not least, let's talk a little bit about Virtual Machine Manager 2012 SP1, and I'll give you a demo after that. So another powerful commandlets that are available with VMM, about almost 500 commandlets are available to manage all sort of things within VMM. So you can really manage your security, all your administrative tasks. You can manage your host, your Hyper-V host or your virtualization hosts. You can manage your virtual machines, your services, your service templates. You can work with all the different profiles that exist within VMM, like SQL profiles, VM profiles, hardware profiles, OS profiles. You can really manage your virtual disks, all your configurations that are part of VMM. So everything is possible using PowerShell commandlets. And here is, again, for reference, here's the URL to get all the details of every commandlet that's available within VMM. And so this is the first slide of three that gives you an overview of all the commandlets that are available. But instead of reading them, I would like to show you that in a demo. So let's get back to the demo environment, to my VMM machine, to show you a couple of things that you can do with VMM PowerShell commandlets. Okay, now we are in my Virtual Machine Manager environment. So I've started already the console, and you can see that I've a virtual machine that's called TestWS 2008. It's currently stopped, so it's not running. One of the things that I'd like to highlight is that, for example, if you go ahead and power on that machine, you can click on that button up here. So it will actually start that that VM. And if you go to the jobs pane down here, you can see that it was already successfully started. But what is interesting here is that for all the different jobs that that were running in the past, you can see the command that was using, so the PowerShell command that was used to make that job happen. So in this case, it was start SC virtual machine. So that's the PowerShell commandlet that's part of the product that was used by the console to start that VM. And the same way, you can use PowerShell only to start a virtual machine without the console. And that's what we're going to do right now in my demo. So let's switch over to my scripting environment, to a different VM. So here we go. So one thing that I would like to show you is also how to, because in this COM demo, we've used some variables that we assigned within the script, which is nice and which is okay. But if you want to use the same script to deploy more agent, or in this case, to start or stop a virtual machine without having the name of that virtual machine as part of the scripts, you can use that construct here, and that's defining parameters. So in this case, we're defining three different parameters. One is the VM name. Another one is the server name, the VMM server name, and then we also have an integer, so not a string, it's an integer value that's called VM value. So we have those three parameters defined. Here are an example of the values. So you have seen the name of the VM is TestWS2008. The VMM server name is VMM01, and the value is 200. So I'm not using those three variables, so they're just there for reference. One thing that you're familiar already, we're creating a session to the VMM server first, then we are calling the invoke command, and everything below that invoke command will be executed on the virtual machine manager. So First thing, we are going to import the module that's called Virtual Machine Manager. So we are getting all the commandlets that are delivered by Virtual Machine Manager. We are getting the VMM server, and then we are starting using that get sc virtual machine command to get our VM that we are working on. So, and therefore we are using the VM name, the variable VM name, which we already passed in to that remote session using the params here. So then we are using a couple of write host lines just to give some sort of interaction and to give some information what's going on within the script. And then we are on that VM, so we have assigned that variable VM with that virtual machine. We are stopping that virtual machine. Right now it was started by us through the console. Right now we want to stop that virtual machine. And then, after that, we not only want to stop that virtual machine, but we also want to change something from a configuration perspective. In this case, we're using the VM value as a value that we're increasing the memory, the virtual memory of that virtual machine with. So what the first thing we are going to do is we're having that memory variable here that takes the memory, the existing configured memory of that virtual machine, and assign it to that variable. And then we're creating another variable that's called new memory MB, which will then have the updated memory value, taking the old one, the existing one, plus the one that we're passing in. So we're taking the VM value variable that was defined as a parameter and add that to the existing configured memory value of that virtual machine. Another two lines of write host to get the current memory and as well as the new memory of that virtual machine. And then we're using a command that's pretty powerful, that's called setVM. And there we can do a couple of things, but in this case, we are taking our virtual machine and we're changing the memory of that virtual machine using the new memory MB variable. And then, after that is done, we're just starting the virtual machine again using the start SC virtual machine and passing in the variable of that virtual machine. And let's go to the end. After that, we're coming back to our VM where the script is actually running, and we're just removing that remote PowerShell session to free up the resources on our machine. So let's get started by calling that that demo. So I just go and go to the right folder, which is called demo, and then I'm calling the VM demo PS1, and what I can see right here are the three parameters that we've defined at the beginning: the VM name, the VMM server name, and the VM value. So I'm able to run that script a couple of times with different values, and all those different values that we are entering now are passed into the script and will be used throughout the script to make the remote session to that, taking that VM name to stop it, change the memory, and start it again using the VM value. So let's go with the VM name first. So that was called TestWS2008. Then we are going to use the VMM server name. That is VMM01. And last but not least, the VM value. And in this case, we're increasing the memory of the TestWS2008 VM by 200 meg. And then we just hit enter. And what we'll see right now is a couple of information lines that will give us some hints where we are in the script. So let's go. So first we see that the TestWS2008 VM will be stopped. We see the information that the current VM status is power off. The current memory was 4,896 MAC, and now it was increased by 200. We're starting that test WS2008 VM, and the current VM status is running again. So let's switch back to see if that was really working. Let's go to the VMM, activate that, and go to the VMs. You can see it is running, and you can see down here the memory information. It was increased up to 5 gig in this case. And we, again, if we run the script again, it will be increased by another 200 meg and so on. And you can also use negative values as well to decrease the memory. And the same way works if you want to change virtual CPUs, for example. That's one example on how to automate Virtual Machine Manager using PowerShell. So that was the last demo about how to use PowerShell commandlets from the different System Center 2012 components. So for the last topic, I would like to talk a little bit about the advanced PowerShell automation. And if you're familiar with the other sessions that I did about Orchestrator and how to use that tool to automate your environment, you will see that that PowerShell session and the Orchestrator session and the technology really integrates to each other very well. So first of all, with Orchestrator, you have those different activities that really helps you to automate stuff in other languages like WMI, Visual Basic Script, some shells, or how to invoke web services, for example, and how to integrate that with existing scripts in the data center. So if you have PowerShell scripts already and you want to integrate that to Orchestrator to do even more than that, I would like to give you a quick demo on how that is possible. And therefore, you have a couple of things like run.net script in the left corner. With that, you can all take all the PowerShell script that I demoed today and take those and copy those into an Orchestrator runbook and do even more than the PowerShell script itself, and integrate that with other tools, other platforms, other vendors, and so on. But therefore, I would like to really highlight the Orchestrator sessions that is available in the Microsoft Virtual Academy if you want to learn more about that. But I would really give you a quick intro to that after this slide. One more toolkit that I would like to highlight is the PowerShell Deployment Toolkit, which is actually a set of scripts that deploy a System Center 2012 SP1 environment. And it really is a very powerful toolkit that really gives you a full System Center 2012 environment, including all the prerequisites, including all the SQL instances, within 2 to 4 hours, completely automated. I've used it myself quite a few times, and it's a really, really great help in setting up a System Center 2012 environment. And here is the link to the Building Clouds blog that will give you some background about that toolkit. You can download it from there, and I really highly recommend that, using that in your environment and make you familiar with that. With that, I would like to go to my last demo about how to use those PowerShell script in some more advanced automation and solutions. So right now we are in an Orchestrator environment. This is the designer, a tool that comes with Orchestrator, where you're actually designing all your runbooks. And what you can see is one runbook that's called SCOM Agent Install. And what I would like to highlight is here that the demo that I showed you before using the SCOM PowerShell commandlet is totally running inside Orchestrator as well. So first, what I'm using here is an initialized data activity that you can just drag and drop from the activities pane on the right side here. And if you double click on that, what you can see is that we have defined two input variables for that runbook. One is the SCOM server and one is the virtual machine that we're using to deploy the agent to. And if you think back on the demo about the SCOM PowerShell stuff that I showed you before, that's exactly the same two parameters that we've used there. Next is the SCOM agent install. So that's a run.net script activity that you see here on the right. You just drag and drop that, you link it together, and if you double click on that, You can choose which type of language you're going to use. So you can use C#, you can use JScript, you can use PowerShell and VB.net. In this case, we're using PowerShell, and we've just copy and paste script that we've used before in PowerShell only to orchestrate it. We just added a couple of more trace information and a couple of error state, error message information. But from a functional perspective, the same script that we've used before, you can just copy and paste that from your PowerShell file or your PowerShell environment to Orchestrator. The only thing that you have to update is that you have to assign the variables from the initialized data activity and add that to the script by subscribing to the data bus, a very powerful concept out of Orchestrator, but I don't want to go into more detail here because that's all part of the Orchestrator sessions that's available as well. So you can just double-click here, subscribe to publish data, and then you're subscribing to the parameters that you've defined in the initialized data activity. And then two more activities that will either return a success or an error information back to the runbook that's calling that SCUM agent install. And with that, you can really build full end-to-end scenarios. For example, provision a new virtual machine completely using Virtual Machine Manager, using templates. You can create templates. You can then join the domain with that new virtual machine. You can install software. You can install this SCUM agent many, many more things that is available with Orchestrator and PowerShell. So they are fully integrated. With PowerShell, you have the opportunities to really automate your environment, Windows Server, System Center components. And with Orchestrator, you can do even more by integrating other vendor tools, other platforms, and so on by using that graphical user interface. So this was the session already about PowerShell and the power of the commandlets that are coming or are provided by the System Center 2012 family. So it's really a very rich environment where you can really automate all sort of administrative tasks. It is well integrated into Windows and System Center. So you saw that it works well with different client and server operating systems. It works well with System Center Orchestrator, so you can automate Orchestrator itself, but you can also take those PowerShell scripts and use it within Orchestrator and build more end-to-end scenarios with a graphical user interface, with all the activities and integration packs that are available today that are provided by Microsoft and third-party vendors to build your end-to-end scenarios across your data center and across the different vendors that you might have. So with that, I'm done with the session, but before we go, I would like to highlight a couple of more things. One is the TechNet Eval Center, available on technet.microsoft.com/evalcenter, where you can download Microsoft software trials today for free. The IT camps, which is available on technet.microsoft.com, global IT camps, and of course the Microsoft Virtual Academy, microsoftvirtualacademy.com, offers free online technical training on all sort of Microsoft products and a really great opportunity to learn about Microsoft technology and deepen your skills. So with that, thank you very much for your attention. And hope to hear and see you very soon on some automation solutions.